mercy. We seek refuge in Allah from the evils of our souls and the consequences of our misdeeds. Those individuals whom Allah Azza wa Jalla guides, no one can ever mislead them. And those people who are misled by Allah will never receive guidance from anyone after Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. I bear witness and I testify with full conviction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only deity worthy of worship, along with my partner. And I bear witness and I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His chosen slave and the last of His prophets and His messenger to all creation. O you believe, fear Allah perfectly and thoroughly, as one should fear Allah, and die not except as Muslims. O you believe, O all mankind, fear your Lord who made you from a single soul, from which He created His wife, from the tomb He brought into existence many men and women, and allowed them to live and dwell throughout the land. Be mindful and conscious of your Maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one whose name you mentioned will be the man your basic mutual rights, and stay far away from severing the ties of kin. Be wary, be watchful, do not come near cutting the relations of your family. For indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a raqib, is one who watches, one who hears, and one who is all aware of that which you say and that which you do. Oh, you believe, fear Allah, speak the truth, say that which is positive, that which is wholesome, that which is correct and sound. If you do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you of your sins and fix and repair and mend for you your misdeeds. And the slave who is obedient and submissive to Allah as a apostle is the most successful and prosperous slave possible. To proceed merit the most excellent speech, the most truthful discourse is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his authentic sunnah. And the worst things are those that have been newly introduced and taken as acts of worship. For every act of worship that was not practiced by Muhammad and his companions, when they agreed upon, was an innovation, and all innovations are in the fire of hell, for they are all misguided to proceed. I find it quite interesting that every time I come to this masjid, we take, in most of the cases, the same rule, the same way that we come. My ears come to this masjid. And in that rule, we pass by something. Something that's very obvious, something that's very big, something that's plain and simple, but I'm sure it's a thing that we take for granted, and we don't utilize, and we do not take or hold on to Allah's hikmah that He gave, that He decreed. And that thing that I pass by every time I come to this masjid is the graveyard. Every single time we visit this masjid, we must go by that graveyard. It's not a small graveyard. It's not a new graveyard, rather it's a very large graveyard, relatively. And it's relatively old. Many people are buried in that place. Hundreds, if not thousands, only Allah knows. And I'm sure many of you brothers and sisters must also pass by that graveyard before you come to this masjid, with the intention of offering prayer, with the intention of benefiting and partaking in the day of Jum'ah, the best day. But how many of us take advantage of that sign that Allah shows us? If Allah had willed subhanahu wa ta'ala, He could have put this masjid away from the graveyard. If Allah azza wa jalla had decreed, if it was His wish and His desire, then He could have made the graveyard to be in a far location from this masjid. But He put the graveyard in the road to the masjid. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, He told His companions when they were in Medina. In other words, at least 13 years went by before Him being with them as their teacher, as their leader, as their spiritual guide, as the one who nurtured and raised them. At least 13 years. Perhaps He said this hadith years after they were in Medina, but we know for sure, accurately, that He was with the companions for 13 years of cultivation. He said to those companions, He says, previously, I made it impermissible for you to visit the graves. You were not allowed to go to the graveyards in Mecca. You were not allowed to go to the graveyards when we made Hijra. You were not allowed to. Because your iman was weak. Because Islam was a new thing to you. Because polytheism, shirk, and kufr was something that you were accustomed to practicing. It's something that we're used to doing. As Allah told us about Musa alayhi salam, and his disciples and his companions. اجعلنا آلهة كما لهم آلهة. اجعلنا إلهًا كما لهم آلهة. He said, make us a deity as they have a deity. In other words, they saw what those people were doing. And they were close to Jahiliyyah. They had just left Jahiliyyah. They had just received the guidance and the knowledge of Musa alayhi salam. And Musa alayhi salam, he criticized them and he repudiated them. And this is very similar to what happened during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the hadith is narrated by Abu Waqid al-Layhi radiallahu anhu. And also companions, they went out to the battle for the name, to fight the mushrikeen, to spread Islam, to stifle kufr in its people. And they saw those mushriks, they saw those polytheists taking a tree, hanging upon that tree their spears, and their bows, and their arrows, and their swords. In other words, yatabarrakuna bishajara. They were seeking Allah's blessings. They didn't want to make shirk. They didn't want to make a partner with Allah. They wanted Allah's barakat and Allah's nasr. But they took a means, a medium, something that wasn't from the sunnah, and that was that tree. So they said, allow us to have a tree, O Messenger of Allah, as they have a tree. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Allahu Akbar inna sunnah. He says, how great is Allah? Indeed, you will follow those people and everything that they do. Some of the scholars of Islam have taken that verse from Surah Al-A'raf, that when Musa was with his people, and he delivered them from Fir'aun, and they passed by the sea, and they saw those people making some type of shirk, some type of misguidance. And this hadith of Abu Waqid al-Layhi radiallahu anhu to say that when a person has just left Jahiliyyah, when a person has not had a long time pass by upon Tawheed, he's not safe from that misguidance. He's not safe from falling and from going back into that balal, that error, that misguidance. And similarly is our hadith that we're speaking about. He says, كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِكُمْ. He says, I forbade you from visiting the graves. Why? Because their iman wasn't strong enough yet. Because their tawheed wasn't strong enough yet. Because he feared that they would fall back into some of the practices of Jahiliyyah with regards to the graves. With regards to making shirk with Allah. Major shirk or minor shirk. Major kufr or minor kufr. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he then says, كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ فَزُورُوهَا فَإِنَّهَا تُذَكِّرُكُمْ الْآخِرَةَ. He says, but now, visit the graves. Go to the graves. Take lessons and morals from the graves, for indeed they remind you of the hereafter. When you see those people, many of them your family members, your relatives, your community members, people that were just like you, better than you, lesser than you, older than you, younger than you, people that had more of the dunya than you did, somewhat less of the dunya than you did, and all of them were equal in the graveyards. It reminds you, it is an eye-opener, it wakes you up, that one day I am going to be in this very same spot. No matter how much knowledge I may have, no matter how much wealth I may amass and pile up and stack up, no matter how many children and sons I have, strong sons, no matter my wife or my husband or my family or my lineage or my genealogy, I'm going to be in this graveyard. And this is from the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said to the companions who knew Allah, haqqan, truly knew Allah, who feared Allah, who were conscious of Allah, who had yaqeen, he said, visit the graves because they remind you of death. Visit the graves because they remind you of the reality of this world that is short. It's not long. If you live for 100 years, it's nothing in comparison to the people in that graveyard. Some of them may have been there for 100 years, 150 years, 70 years, 80 years. And there are other graves that are older than that. Tombs and mausoleums, which people have been there for thousands of years. What is going on in those graves? Are they being punished? Are they being tortured? Are they being roasted by the fire? Are they being smashed and crushed until their ribs intertwine? Do they experience and suffer from the poison of the hellfire? Or are they being blessed? Are they happy? Do they see the Jannah? Do they see their spot in the hellfire that Allah saved them from? Allah Azza wa Jalla clearly tells us about this in the Quran. كُلًّا نُمِدْتُ هَٰؤُلَاءِ وَهَٰؤُلَاءِ مِنْ عَطَاءِ رَبِّكَ وَمَا كَانَ عَطَاءُ رَبِّكَ مَحْظُورًا. Allah says, انظر كيف فضلنا بعضهم على بعض وللآخرة أكبر درجات وأكبر تفضيلا. Allah tells us, look how we give preference to some slaves over others. Look how we make some of our slaves like this and others like that. Some will be in paradise, others will be in the hellfire at the end of the day. Some will be happy in their graves. Some will wait and beg for the establishment of the hour. Rabbi aqim as-sa'a. Rabbi aqim as-sa'a. Oh my Lord, establish the last day. I want to meet you, O Allah. The Messenger of Allah tells us, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه ومن كره لقاء الله كره الله لقاءه وليعلم بالله. Whoever looks forward to meeting Allah, Allah looks forward to meeting him. And Allah loves to meet him. And those who hate, وليعلم بالله. Those who do not look forward to meeting Allah, Allah hates to meet them. Allah tells us, انظر, look. كيف فضلنا بعضهم على بعضهم. How we've given them preference. They're not equal. They're not on the same level. They're not on the same stage, the same station. And then Allah tells us, but in the hereafter, there will be even more difference. There will be a greater difference. There will be more varying levels and degrees. If in the worldly life, we've given some people iman and others have been tested with kufr, then what do you think about the hereafter? The Messenger of Allah with his companions one day, he walked by the graves and he says, إِنَّهُ ذَا لَيُعَذَّبَانِ. He says, these people are being punished as we speak. They're being tortured, they're being tormented. وَمَا يُعَذَّبَانِ فِي كَبِيرٌ. And they're not being tortured for something that's big, something that's major, something that is hard and difficult. And the different interpretations of the people of knowledge with regards to this hadith that's in Bukhari and Muslim. Some of the ulama say that it was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ later on, Bala, rather, nay, innahu lakabir. It was something big that they were doing. And others say that it wasn't something that was difficult to avoid. It wasn't something that was hard to stay away from. They didn't make the worst sins, the biggest sins, but they were being punished in their graves. Why were they being punished in their graves? The Messenger of Allah, he clearly tells us. He clearly explains to us why they were being punished in their graves. But the point that we want from this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislates certain things and decrees certain things. And from them is the reality of death. Death is a reality. However, your children, your family members, your wealth, let alone haram things. These are permissible things to have to enjoy. Let alone alcohol and drugs, and fornication and adultery, all these things, they grind you. They cause you to be intoxicated. They cause you to be in a drunken state that you do not reflect upon death. And if you don't believe this, or if you think it's an exaggeration, then look at your co-workers that are Muslim. Look at your neighbors that are Muslim. Look at the people that you go to school with, college and high school. From the worst things that the non-Muslims have, the thing that they hate the most is death. They hate to talk about it. They hate to mention it. They hate to think about it. And anyone who comes from a non-Muslim background, whether he reverted and came to Islam, return back to fitrah. Anyone who has non-Muslim family members, he knows how it is at a non-Muslim funeral. The people that go dressed in an inappropriate fashion. They don't wear clothes that are humble. They reveal themselves. It's a show. The finest shoes, the finest suits, the most tight revealing clothes, the sweetest smelling perfume. In other words, they're not taking advantage of the reminder of death. What do they do at the funeral? They drink, they eat, they laugh, they gamble, they joke. They fight over what's left of the spoils of that person's inheritance. In other words, they hate to think about death. Allahu Akbar. Even at the funeral itself, when death is in front of them, they don't think about death. And they cannot bear the bitterness of death. And this is why Allah has told us in the Quran, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul shall taste death. And Allah Azzawajal did not say, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ تَمُوتِ. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَيْتَ. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ, every soul will die. No. It says, every soul shall taste it. In other words, it's a bitter taste. A taste that the people don't want. They don't want to go through death. They don't want to think about it. As Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, he says, الْمَوْتُ كَالْحَمَّامِ. He says, death is like an outhouse. It's like a bathroom. Everybody hates that place, but they must use it. They must go to that place. it smells, it's far, but you have to relieve yourself. And that is a similitude of death. It's bitter, it has an agony to it. No one wants to experience it, but it's a reality. It's a reality. Allah has told us in the Quran, أَلْحَاكُمُ تَكَافُرُ حَتَّى زُلْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ. Indeed, you're fighting in the world of life. You're piling up, you're amassing your stocks and your bonds, your bank accounts, what you can build and throw up and compete with the next man has preoccupied you from أَلْحَاكُمُ تَكَافُرُ. What is it preoccupied you from? Allah did not tell us in that surah. أَلْحَاكُمُ تَكَافُرُ, Allah says. In other words, it distracts you from your deen. In other words, it distracts you from death. In other words, it distracts you from that which your soul needs. But it's not going to remain like this, brothers and sisters. You're not going to be allowed to remain in that drunken state. You're going to come out. You're going to become sober, whether you like it or not. And that time is what Allah says in the next verse. Hatta zultumul maqabir. Until you visit the graves, then it's a wake-up call. The Prophet ﷺ tells us in the Hadith, أَكْفِرُ مِنْ ذِكْرِ هَادِنِ الْأَذَاتِ, make an abundant mention of the destroyer of pleasures. Make an abundant mention of the destroyer of pleasures. Make an abundant mention of the destroyer of pleasures. The Prophet ﷺ does not say, remember death. He doesn't say, think of death. He doesn't say, make an abundant mention of death. But he called death the destroyer of pleasures, the thing that will shatter your drunken state.